Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110.
To honor copyright laws, we have removed some audio and video elements from this message. Now here's this week's message.
The Son's dying words to the world, words spoken through pain and great suffering, with passionate love to the ones He was dying to save, are the sum of His life and works, His gift to us, His heart, and the sound bites of God.
Good afternoon. It's good to be here with you guys. Now, I have a little secret for you, but first, is Pastor Andy in this room? No. Okay, so this is our secret. Because I am his wife, as well as the co-senior pastor, I want to tell you that it's his birthday today. Okay? Yes? So when you see him, give him a big hug and say, I heard you're 50-something. Okay? All right, great. Well, about 6 years ago, almost during this time, I found myself on a witness stand, right? And I was there to give character witness to a young adult lady that was part of our church. I had watched this lady grow up since a youth into adulthood, right? And I was close with her family. She actually gave me permission to talk to you about this today, right? So here's what happened and why I took the witness stand. Because like so many young people that I see and talk to, they feel like they're invincible, right? That nothing could ever bad happen to them. Only her choice to drink and drive ended in a tragic story, right? Here's what happened. It was during the holiday time, and she went off with some of her friends, you know, for an evening, and they went to have dinner, and they were drinking, and she has a young son, and so she knew she had to be at work, and she had her son, so she didn't stay out too late, so she went to leave that night, and it was downpouring, right? Lots of rain. It was just like sheets of it, and she did an inventory. She looked at herself, and she said, yeah, I can do this. It's not that far. And so she got in her car, and she got ready to leave, and then this is what she told me. She said as she was going home, she was concentrating so hard, you know, trying to see and do everything well, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, two people stepped in front of her, right? And she hit them, and they went back onto the pavement. Of course, she stopped her car immediately, jumped out, and started rendering aid, right? The whole time thinking, oh, God, how could this have happened, right? And she was trying to help them, and of course, other people start to jump in now, and then the police show up, the ambulance comes and takes the young man who's a college student, and the young woman who's a college student, takes them to the hospital. The police start to do their investigation, and they decide to arrest her, this young woman, and they charge her with drunk driving, right? So the days that followed, the young man, who was the only son of a man, he was very prominent in our community, he dies, okay? They take him off life support system. The girl is forever maimed, right? And so the media now grabs hold of this and what's happened, and they don't really investigate all this stuff. They just come guns a-blazing, right? And they come at this young woman with everything. Like, we want to lock her up and throw away the key, right? It's like the media had judged it without even knowing all this stuff, and that it was tragedy for everybody concerned. And then when I walked into the courtroom that day, I'll never forget it, okay? When I walked in there, there were so many people in the first courtroom that we went into, right? That they had to move us to another courtroom. And as we moved to the other courtroom, I realized that all the people, pretty much except for a half a dozen of us, were there for the other side and just snarling, angry, right? And I looked at this young woman and I just prayed. I was like, Lord, I know she must feel all by herself today, right? And so my heart just broke. You know, when something like this happens, can you ever recover from that? Is there ever going to be redemption? Is that possible when something like this happens? Is there any hope for this young woman, or is she condemned? Lock her up, throw away the keys? Is there any hope? Well, we've been in a series called Sound Bites, and we've been looking at the seven statements that Jesus gives us from the cross. And today, I want to take a look at this fourth statement that he says, and I want to look at it in light of what is he saying and what does that mean for our lives. So pull out your outline. Matthew 27, starting at verse 45, it says this. At noon, darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. And at about 3 o'clock, Jesus cries out in a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means in Aramaic, my God, why have you forsaken me? I believe that this scripture has huge implications on how we should live. And so I want to look at that today. But first, I want you just to dial down. So I'm going to ask you to pray with me, to close your eyes, and I'm going to invite what is called the Holy Spirit, which is God's presence, to be here with us. So just close your eyes. Father God, I thank you. I thank you that you brought each and every person in here to hear this message so that they could be set free, Lord. They could see what you have done for them. So Holy Spirit, I ask that you would just minimize the distraction, Lord, that everyone here can shake off that tiredness and they can indeed focus on the word that you have for them. And Father, I thank you for making what I say clear, Lord, and carrying your heart. You are forever faithful. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, so what is going on here with this verse that I read where Jesus is crying out, right? Well, here's what's happening. When he says this statement, what's happening is the very moment preceding this statement that he says, all the sins of the world were placed upon him, right? That means my sins and your sins were placed upon him. He becomes our substitute now for that, right? For taking on our sins. And he is now going to go to the cross and he's going to take the punishment for what's wrong and he's going to die. 1 John 2:2 says this, he, which is referring to Jesus, he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. And not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. Now I want to go back and I want you to circle atoning because that's not usually a word that we use, right? So I want to talk about it for a second. What does this mean, atonement? It means payment for something you've done wrong or for damages that you've done, right? It's as if I took my car and let's say I backed into your car and I did damage, right? Well, I've got to fix it. That's called atonement, right? And to satisfy the law, you can't just get off scot-free. Somebody has to pay the penalty. Atonement has to happen. It's like justice demands it, right? So how does this atonement work for you and I? Well, let's look at 2 Corinthians 5:21. It says this. God took the sinless Christ and poured into him our sin. Then, in exchange, he poured God's goodness into us. This is a great mystery. And it is indeed a great mystery. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to look at the cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? And we're going to look at that and say, what does that teach us? What is that teaching me for today in 2017? And then knowing what it's saying, what is my response to be? So let's go and look. What is it saying here? Well, the first thing that I hear and see is that God is holy. That's what I see there, that God is holy. That's the first thing it teaches us very loud and clear. In Revelation 4:8, it says this, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come, right? And what I want you to notice is holy, holy, holy is done three times. Why? Because the person writing this wants us to get it, that God is indeed a holy person. It's a very significant point here that we need to understand this, that he is holy. You know, back in Greek mythology or Roman mythology, when you read it, they had their own gods like Zeus or who else is another one? Venus, right? And the different ones like that. But all these mythological gods that they would create were all flawed, carried human flaws. And so you've seen things like they were either lustful, moody, prideful, you know, ambitious. And because of that, they were always getting in trouble, okay? But I'm here to tell you that the one true God, the God of the creator of the universe, right? He is holy. So what does that mean, he is holy? Well, it means 100% perfect. There's no blemish there to be found. He's not corruptible. He is 100% flawless. He's flawless. He is holy. And you see, if you get a God that has imperfections, right, then he's not a God. And you shouldn't be worshiping him. But our God is holy. He is ultimate perfection in every area and every decision he makes. He's holy. And because God is holy and he is perfect, he cannot stand in the presence of imperfection. He just can't do that. And because God is holy, he can't even look at corruption or evil or wrongdoing. We see that in Habakkuk 1:13 as it describes God. It says this, "Your eyes, Lord, are too pure to look on evil." You cannot even tolerate wrong. So you see this immense holiness that God is carrying with him, right? So now you drop back to the cross and we see Jesus Christ on the cross. And remember that Jesus Christ is God in human form that has come down to earth to die for us, to take the penalty for our sin, right? So you see him on the cross right now. And so what does that mean, takes on the penalty for our sins, right? That means that he's going to take every act that is evil, every act of child molestation, every act that's a rape, or every time sex trafficking has been done, or every time a terrorist gets in a car and mows down people. That's the stuff that he's taken. Every time somebody was disloyal or, you know, or lying or cheating, he's taking all those things on himself. He's allowing all of those sins to be placed on his shoulder. And I don't know about you, but this blows my mind. Like, how could that happen? But that's indeed what Jesus did. He took them all on himself. And for the moment that he took it on himself, right? Because God is holy, he couldn't even look at his own son. And he turns his back on his son, right? Because he couldn't even look at it. And when he turns his back, here's what's happening. For the first time in Jesus' life, he feels a relationship that is broken. It's broken, right? I mean, here Jesus has been with God because he's part of the Trinity. He's been with him for his whole existence. And they've had perfect harmony and perfect unity together. They've been together. They've never known separation. And all of a sudden, Jesus at that moment is separated from his God. And that's what the cry is. That's the anguish from his heart when he says, my God, why have you rejected me? It's the absence of that relationship that causes him to cry out. And we know that God had no choice because of who he was than to walk, to turn his back. And so knowing this, we learn from that cry that God is indeed holy. The second thing it teaches you and I is that sin is so ugly. It is so ugly. And I say that and I know I'm finding an uphill stream because our culture glorifies sin, right? Every movie and song and books that are written, they all make sin look so attractive, so appealing, right? You know, everybody's doing it. It's the cool person that does it. Only those that are ignorant or, you know, not cool, then they listen to God and follow his rules. So it almost juxtaposed it. Of course you didn't do that. It's almost like our culture has a narrative out there that says sin is exciting, it's fun, and, you know, desirable. Go after it. A good example of this, and I might date myself here, but if you ever watch the James Bond movies, please say yes. Good. Thank you. Okay. My first audience is like, what? Okay. Well, for you younger people, you can just put in their Mission Impossible or something. Okay. Well, for the James Bond movies, what you see is this character, right? And he's this high action, you know, dude. And he just moves from one woman to the next, right? He goes and he has an interlude with one woman's bed. And then a few scenes later, he's in with another one. He's like a playboy. And so all you see is this beautiful, sexy, romantic interlude. And then, like I said, he's off to the next one. What you don't see is all the hearts that are broken here, right? Because movies and things like that, they never show you the repercussions of stuff like that. They just don't. They don't show you the consequences of sin. They don't talk to you about the STDs, the sexually transmitted diseases. They don't talk about that, right? They don't talk about all the unwanted pregnancies and the resulting a lot of time in the abortions. Didn't talk about stuff like that. No, not at all, right? It glorifies, it makes it look so good. And it certainly doesn't talk about all the children that have no fathers that are born. So to me, sin is so ugly. It's so ugly because it produces things that cause such devastation in people's lives. And so I want to tell you, don't buy into the narrative that you see going on in your culture. If I'm a voice for that and nothing else, then I'll be a voice for that. Stand up. Don't buy into that stuff. In Isaiah 59:2, it says this: "Your evil has separated you from your God, and your sins have caused him to turn away from you." Again, underscoring the fact that God wants you to see what sin actually is, because if you don't, it separates. It has a tendency to separate you and him. The next thing I look when I see this teaching and Jesus calling out is that salvation is very costly. It's very costly. You know, the Bible says that God's gift is eternal life and the salvation, and he says it's a free gift, but it is not cheap. Somebody had to pay for it, guys. Look with me in Romans 3:25. It says God has sent Jesus to punish, God sent Jesus to take the punishment for our sins and to satisfy God's anger against us. We were made right with God when we believe that Jesus shed his blood, sacrificing his life for us. Okay? So we need to know that Jesus paid this price. And I want to underscore the paying of the price and this whole idea of justice and mercy. I want to tell you a story. All right? There was two guys who grew up in New York City in one of the suburbs, and they were the best of friends. You couldn't separate them, right? And so they grew up together, and they actually went to college together, and then they decided they're going to go into law together. And so they spent a lot of time. Well, they graduated from law school, but their lives took two entirely different directions. One guy, he goes on to become a well-respected federal judge court judge. Right? So in New York. And so he's doing that. The other guy now, he gets messed up with cocaine, right? Some bad stuff there. And so when he gets messed up with that, he turns to a life of crime, right? To support his habit. Well, many years later, the second guy I'm talking about, he gets fraud charges brought up against him, is what happens there. And so now he has to go to court and stand before a judge. And the judge that he will be standing for that's assigned to his case is his best friend, right? And so now everybody knows this. They know that the relationship is there. They know that there are friends, right? And so everybody's speculating, will the judge show leniency because it's his friend? But the judge does something that's remarkable. It's surprising, right? After hearing the case, he hands down to his friend the largest fine possible by law. And then he pushes back after he does that and the gavel comes down, bang. He pushes back from the chair he's in and he walks from behind the bench that he is. He takes off his little robe, he puts it over, right? And then he goes down and he pays for the man's fine. The whole entire thing is paid for. So what's happening here? Justice and mercy. Justice and mercy. And is that not what Christ has done for us? You know, that God being holy requires for the justice to take place for all the wrongs that are done, right? We have to have justice to take care of those wrongs. And then the mercy comes in when Jesus says, yes, but I'll take it. I will pay the penalty. I will pay the fine. Galatians 3:13 says, Christ has rescued us from the curse pronounced by the law. When he was hanging on the cross, he took upon himself the curse for our wrongdoings. Guys, nobody's going to love you more than God loves you. They're just not. And nobody's going to sacrifice more for you than Jesus Christ did. And so you need to know that. And so out of that great love and what Jesus is teaching us from the cross and is crying out, what should our response be? On your outline, the first one and most important one is you need to turn from your sin and trust Jesus Christ. You need to turn from your sin and trust Jesus Christ that he will save you. In Romans 3:22, it says this: we were made right in God's sight when we trust Jesus Christ to take away our sins. And we all can be saved in this same way, no matter who we are or what we have done. No matter what we have done, no matter where you are today, no matter what's going on around you, God says that he's not a respecter of person. He will forgive you. He will cleanse you. He will set you free. You no longer have to live under self-condemnation. You don't have to nail yourself to the cross because Jesus has died for you. He was nailed to the cross for you. But you must trust him. You must trust him in that. Hebrews 10:26 says this, if we deliberately keep on sinning after we've received the knowledge of the truth, that's what we're talking about, the knowledge of the truth, that Jesus Christ loved you and took the penalty for your sins, no sacrifice for our sins is left for us. And so what this is saying is that if you turn away from the message today and you hear and you know that Jesus Christ was given to you for your atoning sacrifice, right, that he took the penalty of your sin, if you decide today to turn away from it, there's nothing then. There is no other God. There is no other way, right? There is no other way. There's only one way, and that's through Jesus Christ. And if you refuse to allow Jesus Christ to be your advocacy, right, that he pleads on your behalf, he takes that atonement for you. If you do not call on him to do that for you, then the very Jesus I'm talking about will become your judge, right? Because 100% of us, that means everybody in here, you will die, and you will stand before the Lord, and you have to give an account for your life. And so you want to have that, you want to have Jesus to have taken care of that for you. Now, I believe that God brought you here today to hear this message because there are some of you that are in here and you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ or you've walked away from him. And he's calling you home. He's calling you back. But here you go. Here's what I know about Jesus. He gives you the opportunity, the choice. He never forces you. So he'll tell you the truth, but you have to declare it yourself. The scripture says, those that believe in their heart and confess with their mouth, so shall they be saved. Which means that you have to make that decision yourself. It's not enough just to know about it. You must accept it for yourself. God brought you here. I hope you do that today. And then I'm going to ask you at the end of the service, I'll give you the opportunity to pray with me. Okay? We'll do that. It's a private thing. You can do it right where you're at. But I'm going to ask you to fill out a form or the Connect card that Aaron was talking about so that you can tell me so I can call you. Because you need to be telling people about it so they can help you to grow in that decision, okay? So that's our first and most important response to the cross. The second one is you and I need to live in a state of assurance and gratitude, of assurance and gratitude. We need to say and get, Jesus gets us, right? We're pretty messed up people, but Jesus gets us. He understands our pain and our confusion. He really gets us. And when we receive what he has done, we partner up with him. His Holy Spirit exists in us. And so we need to have assurance. Listen, you need to have assurance that God will never turn his back on you. Ever. Right? Why is that? Because when we accept Christ, he doesn't see your sin. He doesn't see mine. He just sees Jesus. And Jesus is paid. He's paid the price, so he doesn't see our sins. And because of that, you and I should walk with confidence in whatever trial that's hitting us, no matter what's going on in our lives. I see that. No matter what is happening, even if your marriage is crumbling and you're like, dang, I just don't know if I can hang in there, right? Or you're trying to deal with people that have betrayed you and you're thinking, oh, or your job, it's grinding on you, right? Or you made a decision that has huge ramifications, like the young woman I was talking about, and you're wondering, is there any hope? Will anybody stand with me? Yes, Jesus stands with you. He loves you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. You can lean on him. You don't have to lean on your own understanding. You lean on him, and he'll be there for you. He will never walk out of you, out on you. He won't do that. You matter to him. And you're important to him. In Romans 5:11, it says, now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God, all because of what our Lord Jesus has done for us in making us friends of God. That's what he sees. When he looks at you, he sees his friend. He wants you to walk around with that confidence, and he wants you to be joyful. No matter what's coming into your life, know that God's in control here. The next response that I think that we need to be having has to do with temptation. Now, I know in my life, temptation comes often, knocking on the door of my heart and my mind, and it's like, will you let me in, right, Sharon? And I know it's true with you. So this next thing I learned from the cross is that I need to remember what my sin cost Jesus. I need to remember, what does my sin cost Jesus? When temptation comes, I'm going to suggest that you pause and you think about, that's what put Jesus on the cross. So here you go. The next time you want to be mean to somebody because they just perturbed you off, right? Then you got to stop and you got to pause and says, if I react, that puts Christ back on the cross. I don't want to do that. Or how about this? Next time when you're wanting to do your own thing, right, and you're married and you're thinking, I deserve this, right, and you got that selfish thing going on, might just be me, but it happens, right, where we just kind of want to do our own thing, well, and it hurts somebody else, well, that's like putting cross back on, you know, Christ back on his cross, and we don't want to do that. Or if you're tempted to lie, just a little white lie, it's enough to put Christ back on the cross. And you don't want to do that. You want to avoid that. Sin is ugly, and it's serious business, guys. 1 Peter 1:18 and 19 says this, God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. The ransom he, which is Jesus, paid was not mere gold and silver. He paid for you with the precious lifeblood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. And so you need to know that when temptation comes, God is equipping you to be able to push back from it, right? He wants you not to give in, because when the sin comes knocking on your door, you know, it's beckoning. I want you to act this way. I want you to do this. You need to know, if you are a Christ follower, that you have the Holy Spirit inside of you. I have people say sometimes, they'll say to me, Sharon, how do you know it's sin? I say, because the Holy Spirit's inside of me. And he doesn't just whisper, that's wrong. Oh, no. The Holy Spirit goes, hey, you, stupid, right? I mean, he yells inside of me, don't do it. Sirens are going off. Back, girl, walk back, right? The Holy Spirit brings to our conscience the wrongness of something. And we need to be able to know at that point, you stand in a road and you have a choice. You can yield to the Holy Spirit and what he's telling you and agree with him, or you can decide to justify. I deserve this. I deserve this. It doesn't really hurt anybody anyway. And you can justify why you're going to go do this thing. But let me tell you, I have found that the great equalizer when sin has come and knocking at my door, temptation, the great equalizer for me is to voice what's going on. Oh, no, I'm not going to be disrespectful to my husband, because if I do that, that's putting Christ back on the cross, and I love the Lord Jesus. I'm not doing that, no matter how angry I get at him. Do you see that? It has a way of tempering us. It's a great equalizer, and we learn that when we watch how Jesus responded on the cross. The next thing, and last, is that this message that we have, we need to be sharing it. Number four. I need to tell others about the good news. We need to tell others about the good news. I don't know about you, but when Jesus Christ entered my life, he made such a difference. Oh my goodness. Such a difference. It was like day and then it became night, or night and then day, right? I mean, just like stark difference in my life. Now looking back, I can see it. At the time, it all kind of was meshy. But as I get older, I can see the dividing line that took place there. We have this message. God has given us a second chance through his son, Jesus Christ. And this message, we might not be the best at, saying it and being put it out there. But let me tell you, it's important and it needs to get out. Now, the young lady I was talking about earlier, the young adult, I want to tell you a little bit more what happened here. She did go to court and she was convicted and she spent many years in jail. She was taken away from her family and her child. And that's hard. But I'm going to tell you, when she was in prison, she made a decision, because as a child, she had given her life to Christ. But when she was in prison, she decided to go after God like she never had before, right? And so she started with her whole heart searching God. And it was there that she found that peace and that forgiveness. It was there she began to understand the atoning sacrifice that God had. Something that she could never atone for, Christ could atone for her. And so she began to understand that reality. And I'm going to tell you, in the prison that she was known as Miss Evangelist, right? Because she would tell everybody about what she had found, the peace and the love and the forgiveness. And then when she got out, that didn't go away. She's like a little magnet. Everybody's always, you know, coming towards her, her personality and the love of Christ. Now, guys, she would be the first one to tell you she is not perfect. She still struggles. She has good days. She has bad days. But on all days, she knows that her God loves her and he has forgiven her. And because of that, she can face tomorrow. Now, here's the deal. No matter what you got going on in your life, you need to know that God is there with you. He's taking care of it. And that the fact that he is your message. And so you need to turn and you need to look at people that are working with you or in your social group or going to school with you, right? Your family members, your friends. And you need to be telling them what's happening inside, what Jesus has done for you. It's so very, very important, so very vital. Look at this last one here, 2 Peter 3:9. It says this, God is patient. This shows God's heart. God is patient for your sake. He doesn't want to destroy anyone, but wants all people to have an opportunity to turn to him and change the way they think and act. So that's what God is after. God loves people. God loves people, and he wants all people to be with him. But he loves so much, he'll give you the choice always. And I've been doing ministry for over 30 years, and I can tell you the number one thing that makes a difference in somebody's life when we're walking through life is when we take the time to share with them about the difference God has made in our lives. And we invite them to come and to see, to be a part. And so here's my challenge to you today, okay? My challenge is on your outline is that Easter is coming up. And I know that Easter is kind of like Christmas, right? Easter is a time of the year that people are always wanting to go to church. They're like primed and ready to go. And so my challenge to you is to begin to pray, to look and survey the people that God has put around you. I'm not asking you to go knock on the doors of your neighbors. No, because God doesn't work. Here you go. God works right in your sphere. Right with the people that are around you and start to ask him, is there somebody that I can invite to church this Easter? Don't come by yourself. Bring them so that they would be able to hear the message that transforms our life and encounter the Christ that can do that. Now bow your heads with me. Okay, Lord. Father, I thank you that I asked for your spirit to be here, and indeed it has been. You are so faithful. More, Lord. I wait upon you, Father. Yeah. Okay. So everybody's head is bowed and all the eyes are closed. But I want to talk, and you, if you don't know Christ, you can look right up here at me, okay? Jesus brought you here today because you matter to him. He loves you. And so he wants to make peace with you, and not on your terms, on his terms. And his terms is accepting his son as your Lord and your Savior. And if that's what you want today, I'm going to encourage you to pray right where you are with me, right this moment. He hears you. No magical words. He looks at the intent of your heart. And so you just say right now, Father God, go ahead and say that. Say, Father God, I don't understand it all, but I want to come close. And so I thank you, Jesus Christ, for taking on my sins and for forgiving me. And the best way I know how, I give you my life and the leadership of it. Fill me with your presence. Okay, very good. Now I'm gonna pray for you guys that were praying that. And everybody's head that's bowed, you be praying also. Father God, I thank you that your word tells us that when a heart cries out to you, that you do by no way ever reject them. That you actually take that prayer and it's precious. It's a pleasing aroma that comes up, and that you actually write their name in the book of life, that they are a child of the God Most High. And that when you see them now from this point on, you will always see them through Christ's blood. And so, Father, I thank you for them, and I ask that you would now nurture them and take care of them, Lord. and give him the courage, Father, to step and to see now what. And Father, for your word today, Lord God, I thank you for reminding many of us of what was done on the cross and in preparation for this Easter, this Lent season that we're upon right now, that we're in. Father, I thank you that you are impassioned and that you want us to prepare ourselves that we might come to that Easter, to that resurrection, and truly understand the dynamics that's going on there, Lord. And so I thank you for that clear understanding. And Father, I also ask for empowerment for those to hear what your Spirit was saying, that you would show them what's their next move, Lord. Whether it's inviting somebody or getting some help with temptation, whether it's rejoicing in the tough seasons. So Holy Spirit, I thank you that you have put a covering over these things that we lift up before you, because you know, God says he knows what's on your heart. He knows you, and he knows you, and he wants you to know that he's there, right there with you, right in that season. And so, Father, I thank you for your love and mercy today. I thank you that as we pray that we would be able to love you with all of our heart, with all of our mind, and with all of our soul, Lord God, and all the breath of life that you've given us. As we move towards you, you move towards us, and you help to raise us up. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.